Annyeonghaseyo, my name is Sarah, and welcome to Mile High Church. Thank you for spending a portion of your weekend with us, especially if you're new. Before we get started today, we want to give you a look at a few things coming up for you and your family at Mile High Church. Our bereavement team is offering The Morning After, a healing class for anyone who has experienced a significant loss. Class starts this Thursday, but please sign up soon as registration closes tomorrow. And our Interfaith Kirtan event is coming up this Wednesday with the Bhakti Shakti Band. Come sing, dance, and celebrate together in community.
Hi, we're here with our friend Stacy.
And we're talking about Fall Fest.
So when is Fall Fest?
Fall Fest is coming up on Saturday, October 14th from 10 to noon.
Will there be candy?
There will be so much candy.
Will there be games?
There will be games.
Can we look at some pictures?
We can. All right, what kind of candy do we have?
Where are the candy canes?
No candy canes at Trunk or Treat.
But I don't want to go to Trunk or Treat if there are no candy canes.
For more information on anything you've heard today, visit the Event Center or connect with us online at milehighchurch.org. Annyeonghaseyo.
Go ahead, Mike. Welcome, welcome to Sunday at Mile High Church. We're going to sing one of my favorite songs. It is All the Good. It talks about we can't do all the good the world needs, but the world needs all the good that we can do. Here we go.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, I'd love to blame the sound guy, but that was all me. Thank you, Nathan. Let's hear it for Nathan, our incredible sound engineer. Welcome to Mile High Church. We're so glad that you're with us here in our Teal Sanctuary or watching online. We have two members of our dynamic youth program, Charlotte and Olivia, who are going to talk to us today about our vision and our mission.
Hello. I'm Olivia, and this is Charlotte, and we are here to read our vision and mission.
What's vision and mission?
Oh, it's just a few sentences about who we are and what we stand for here at Mile High Church.
Okay, let's do it.
Our vision, oneness revealed.
Hang on. I don't know what that means. Oneness revealed?
Oh, it means that we are all connected. We are one. We are one big human family.
Cool. How about I read it and you tell me what it means? A world of love, peace, and abundance for all.
Mile High Church teaches us to be loving and kind to each other, and abundance for all. That means that if we all work together, there's enough for everybody.
Enough food and money and stuff like that?
Enough food, money, love, laughter, and joy. Enough everything.
I like that. Our mission, to serve as a spiritual bacon. Bacon?
Beacon. It's a really bright light.
Okay. To serve as a spiritual beacon. bacon for personal empowerment.
Personal empowerment means that each one of us has power, and we want everyone to know how powerful they are.
And global enlightenment.
Whew, that's a big one. It means that each one of us, it means that as we send our light and our love out to the whole world, and as we do that, we meditate and pray, we can change the world.
I think we can change the world if we all work together.
Will you help us? And so it is.
Thank you, Charlotte and Olivia, for letting us, reminding us what our church is all about here. I also want to acknowledge Geraldine Thiel, who on behalf of our practitioners is lighting our peace candle today. We introduced that when the war in Ukraine started. It's not something we can mention every week, but we want folks who are affected by war to know that we're holding them in our heart. And I don't know about you, but I was so shaken yesterday in hearing about this brutal attack on Israel and of the innocent deaths on both sides of the conflict that are taking place. It breaks the heart. And even as a minister, my first response isn't peaceful. And yet, you know, that's what we're all about here, is we're all about holding a greater peace for humanity, however long it takes to get there. And it doesn't befall me either to recognize that as part of our adventures in faith, we're doing different spiritual practices every week. Today's is from Sufism, the mystical heart of Islam. Next week is from Judaism and the powerful practice of the Sabbath. And it reminds me that we don't get to choose about what connects us. It's already so, but we do have to consciously choose about what divides us and what separates us. And here at Mile High Church, it's up to each one of us to hold that oneness and that unity for humanity. So let us hold all of those affected by this terrible tragedy in our hearts and in our consciousness as we move into this time of song, of silence, and prayer.
Surely the presence of God is in this place. I can feel the mighty power and the grace. I can hear the brush of angel wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence God is in this place. Surely the presence of God is in this place. I can feel the mighty power and the grace. I can hear the brush of angel wings, I see glory.
what I recognize, the only one present is God in this moment. And moment by moment, attentiveness to the goodness of life opens that doorway of our hearts. Open it. Enter in to the fullness and to the glory of that infinite presence, that Almighty God, that God that knows no distress. It knows only peace. It knows health and wellness. And most importantly, it radiates so much love. So I recognize and accept that each one of us, all of us gathered here this day, all of our beautiful folks online, I behold that Mile High Church is a lighthouse, and that light is shining forth from each one of our hearts. Life has asked us to step up into that heart space, and to know this holy truth. For we are one, not separate. We are one, and we are sacred. And so out of this inner sacredness, of this incredible heartfelt consciousness, I behold that there's a field of light. And this field of light is surrounding you. It is surrounding our beautiful community. And I behold that it is surrounding Grandmother Earth. It is there for all those who have experienced the conflicts, those who have experienced such rumble from the earth. I behold that spirit is holding them in the palm of its hand. So we place our hand on our hearts. We recognize that spirit, divine love, that harmonious love is present. And it's present here this day in the beautiful message of Reverend Josh, Reverend Zamira in her presentation, the beautiful music, and most importantly, it's shining so brightly from each one of you. So allow your light to shine this day with gratitude in our hearts, with the inner sense of knowing. I declare, calling forth on that universal law, which is a pattern that acts upon our belief, and I believe, and it is done. And so it is. Amen.
Imagine what you want. Get out of the way, you know, energy follows thought, so be careful what you say. Be careful what you ask for, make sure it's really what you want, because your mind was made for thinking, and energy follows thought. Mind is in control, even when you do not know. And if you let it idle, ain't no telling where it'll go. Whenever you are sleeping and your dreams take you away, go on with your dreaming. Listen to what they say. And if you hear spirits talking, the wisdom can't be bought. Apply it to your thinking, and energy follows thought. mind is in control, even when you do not know. And if you let it idle, ain't no telling where it'll go. Imagine what you want and get out of the way. Remember, energy follows thought, so be careful what you say.
So for our adventures in faith, spiritual practice this week, as Josh so beautifully mentioned, comes to us from Sufism. And Sufism is the mystical branch of Islam, but more than that, it is a philosophy and it is a way of life. And I am an ordained Sufi minister as well. And when we practice in community or at home, we open with the invocation, which I'm going to share with you now. So if you'll join me with a deep breath. Towards the One, the perfection of love, harmony, and beauty, the only being united with all of the illuminated souls who form the embodiment of the mystery, the spirit of guidance. And we also have in Sufism a spiritual practice of recitation of the 99 names of God, known as a wazifa. And we recite these names of God in order to embody or to awaken within ourselves that God quality that that particular name calls forth in its resonance, in its vibration as we recite it. So this morning I'm going to recite, and we're going to recite together, one of the 99 names of God, Al-Ghani. And that will be our focus for today. And you will see that I will, as I recite, I use these prayer beads known as the tasbih. And the tasbih is much like the mala, or the rosary, in which there are three sections and they're divided by 33. So as we recite the names, we're not going to recite all 33 recitations today, or 99, but you will recite sometimes 33 out loud, 33 recitations on a whisper, or 33 recitations silently to make 99. Al-Ghani is focused on bringing us into the garden of our heart. And what it means too is to connect with that all-sufficiency, the abundance that is God. And so as we recite this morning, we tune in to that inner garden within our hearts to sense what is growing there. And so as we begin this wazifa practice, I'd ask you to go within now and take another deep breath, centering your attention in your heart. And as you breathe in and out, just sense and see what is there. As we breathe in, you can say to yourself, Ya Ghani, and feel it resonating through you. Sense the boundaries within your heart and sense where, and perhaps consider even, what lies within your heart, what is growing there, and what lies outside. And as we breathe in again, Ya Ghani, that essence of the ni, that long E sound, draws forth the life force within us. And so now we begin together. Ya Ghani, 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 Ya Ghani. and so it is, and so we let it be.
All are gathered together in this place. Why are we here? What is our purpose? And what is His will? How do we know what's true and what's real? We may not know where life's road will lead, but it doesn't matter long as we believe that God is the answer. God is the answer. God is the answer to whatever the question maybe. What's going on in this world today? Where do we fit? What can we do to make a difference? What can we say? Where do we turn? This way or that way, if we all pray and truly believe and love one another, we can make this world see that God is the answer. Yes, God is the answer.
Tom Litch, thank you so much. Bijou Barbosa, Mike Marlier on drums, Rob Lowe, our beloved Dr. Kent Rattenstrauss, everybody. Thanks again to Charlotte and Olivia for their explanation of what we teach here by sharing our vision and mission. And thanks to Reverend Zamira and our interfaith ministry for bringing us these spiritual practices. If you're here in the sanctuary, you can grab that practice, a flyer over the guest services counter, or you can get it online as well, where you can also get our Adventures in Faith small group materials. You don't have to be in a small group to use those. You can start a small group with yourself or with your partner or a loved one. And I wanted to take a moment this morning to recognize the committee that put all this together. So if you're here, raise your hand. Thank you so much, Paula Connolly, Dodie Jackson, Tom Litch, Steve Jansen, Reverend Zamira Jezwirska, and Diane Short. Let's hear it for all of them. Thank you so much. Before I move into the message this morning, I want to honor the passing of a lifelong Mile Higher, Brad Dalby, who made his transition surrounded by loved ones yesterday morning. His parents are an important part of the congregation. His daughter, Nicole, served on our Adventure in Faith committee last year. And for all of those that love him, especially his children, I just affirm that that father's love for you never dies, that it is eternal. And my prayer, even in these tough times of letting go, is that love shows up in your life, in your conversations, in the days ahead, and for the rest of your days as well. So we send our love to the Dalby family this morning. It's Adventures in Faith, spirituality from the ground up, and our message today is in the garden. Sam Lewis, an incredible American Sufi teacher, he once said the following: I feel like a gardener who one year planted a bunch of seeds and nothing grew. And then the next year planted more seeds and nothing grew. And then the next year planted more seeds and nothing grew. And then this year I planted some seeds and they began to grow. And so did the seeds from the year before that. And so did the seeds from the year before that. And here I am running around catching all that I can. And then God spoke to me and said, harvest what you can and I'll take care of the rest. I don't know about you, but I really resonate with that. All the time, we are planting seeds of intention into a creative mind, a soul or a soil that is seeking to bring forth those intentions. There's intentions I will set today for tomorrow. There are intentions of the heart that I planted years or perhaps even decades ago. There are seeds of frustration and uncertainty, seeds of anxiety and seeds of trust, seeds of faith and seeds of hope. No wonder it takes so much for the creative soil to work its way through all of our seeds and weeds and plants to bring forth our intention. And when I look at the broad view at my life, two words come to me: answered prayer. Answered prayer. These seeds didn't always grow the way that I asked them to, but they've worked through so much in my life, including my own limited consciousness, to answer those prayers. Is that true for you as well? I've planted broad seeds. I planted the seed to want to make a spiritual impact on the world and help as many people as possible. Planted the seed to want to spend the majority of my time with a beautiful woman who I have genuine affection for. I set seeds to, as an individual, live for causes and people greater than I am, to humbly love and to serve. I never planted the seed to become a Mile High minister. It was 8 years ago this week, it was 2015, and I was having a stressful day. I was with someone in crisis, and I was late to pick up my son from school, and I kept missing this call from the 720 number. And so I'm in the car, really busy, and I go ahead and answer the phone with that, who the heck is this consciousness? You ever do that? And it was Roger Teal. Someone who I really, really admired. I had met one time but never had a conversation with. And so here is my opportunity, rushing through traffic and ambulances whooshing by, to get to talk to Roger. And Roger invited me to come and speak at Mile High Church sometime in 2016. And I got to guest speak for you in April. Never was in my intentions. And I remember picking my son up from school. How was your day? It was fine. How was your day, Dad? And I shared, well, I just got a call from this minister I really admire, and I get to go speak at our largest church in Colorado. And his first response was, when are we moving there? And you can have those experiences in your life where you feel that creative soil starting to work beneath you and all around you. I didn't know what would happen, but something was happening, right? Maybe right now in your life, there's something that's blossoming if you're ready to step into it. See, for me, I don't just set seeds of intentions, but I think for all of us, there's a divine presence that rests seeds deep in our heart that are always seeking to grow so that we can embody and become our best selves. Thomas Merton, in his brilliant New Seeds for Contemplation, shares, "The seeds that are planted in my liberty at every moment by God's will are the seeds of my own identity, my own reality, my own happiness, my own sanctity. To refuse them is to refuse everything. It is the refusal of my own existence and being, of my identity, of myself. Not to accept and love and do God's will is to refuse the fullness of my existence." I love that phrase, the fullness of our existence. Rooted in you like the seed of an acorn, the most real soul possibility that we can step into if we can begin to view our life like a garden designed to answer our prayers. So I'm 27 years old and I'm as single as can be. And where are my single folks? Where are you? You here? Everyone's going, oh, where? Hmm. And there's that dichotomy of both wanting more than anything in the world a relationship and also wanting just as much to be rid of this wanting for a relationship. Maria Bamford, the great comedian, once said, "I don't know if I want to get married or perhaps I just want to be put in a vat of warm rising bread dough." Sometimes my wife refers to me as that. And so I'm frustrated, and I take out a pen and paper, and I decide I'm going to really write down what I want in a relationship. And I wrote down three things. The first is I want to meet her through synchronicity or fate. The second is I want that soulmate feeling. I want to feel like I've known her forever. And third, I learned this through a lot of trial and error, I want her to feel the same way. Always a good idea. And I looked at that list, and I immediately realized that all three of those things were utterly and completely out of my control. That it would only be through tending to my own self and preparing for such a relationship that I would get it. And the real truth was, I didn't see it then, I see it now, is that the garden of my life had already provided me just that. Her name was April. I had met her synchronistically 10 years before that. Not only did we already know each other forever, but we were already bonded and really understood one another's hearts and what we were about. And by some miracle, she just happened to feel kind of sort of the same way. But what I know about our relationship is that it happened when I was ready for it. If it would have happened a day sooner, I would have messed it up. And that can be so true in our life sometimes. We have to build that space. I had to grow a consciousness of coupledom. And my wife might tell you, even though I was totally faithful, I kind of behaved like a single person for several years in a relationship. She would have pointed out some material things as well, such as it would have been a good idea if I had bought a bed. You know, when you go to bed watching SportsCenter every night, who needs a bed? Or I had yet to take that big bachelor rite of passage from Dustbuster to buying a vacuum. But the relationship blossomed when we were both ready, and I'm so grateful it happened the way that it did. One of the best things we can do for ourselves in our lives is think like a gardener. When it comes to the garden of your life, think like a gardener. Ask yourself, what seeds am I planting today? What is a seed of intention that I want to plant in the creative medium of my life to come forward for me. Do you know what it is? Next, what is the environment that my seed, my plant, needs to grow? What is the time that it takes? What is the kind of attention that it needs? What needs to be cleared out, the weeds, to create space for this to grow? I want to step into this thing that serves me. Am I willing to let go of that which is no longer serving me? We cannot grow seeds of love, peace, and joy in a consciousness of despair. Am I willing to have an open consciousness to let that love or that joy that I'm seeking to bring forth in? Am I a healthy environment for my garden to grow? And then lastly, how today can I tend to my garden? How can I nurture those seeds? How can I create space? How can I pay attention to what's most important to me and what matters so that it can grow in incredible ways? In his classic, This Thing Called You, our founder, Ernest Holmes, in immortal words, he shares, "Guard well this garden of your mind. It is God's garden of your soul. It is your garden of Eden, wherein may grow your fondest desires and hopes, blossoming into fulfillment. Or, if you permit, the weeds of destruction, fear, and doubt will choke out the beauty of hope until despair alone remains." Ugh. Watch carefully, then, this garden of your soul. Plant there only seeds of happiness, of joy, of peace, and of goodwill. Go often into your garden. Sitting under the tree of life in cool, quiet communion, you will find fresh inspiration. God himself will go forth anew into creation through you. A couple questions, if you're willing, to ask yourself every day this week. Ask yourself, what is really happening? What in my life today is really happening? How may it be connected to a seed of intention I have planted for myself? And what can I embody to nurture the formation of that seed into flower today? What in my life today is really happening? How might it be connected to a seed of intention I have planted? And how can I nurture that seed in flowering today? In other words, who am I called to become to focus towards nurturing what I want instead of getting caught up in the weeds of what I don't want? I never planted a seed of intention to be a stepfather. And yet I got to build a relationship with an incredible young boy named Gavin when he was 5 years old, who just happened to be the son of April. And loving and caring for this kid was the most natural thing in the world to me. It's different when they're teenagers. Do you know who you never have to explain the theory of the multiverse to? Parents of teenagers. Because you can be in a car ride as close as can be with infinite galaxies between you. And yet Gavin, in his younger years, it was so clear what he was calling for in his life. Someone to love him, to see him, to wrestle with him, to uplift him, to support him. It was easy. What I didn't realize at the time for me is he was the perfect person to teach me about something I'd been avoiding my whole life, family. He was the perfect person to teach me about the blessing of family. And yet, as easy and as natural as the relationship was, I had these mind weeds. Do you ever get these mind weeds? Stepdad, I don't know if I want to be a stepdad. Kids cost money. This is an investment. There are so many other things I think I could be doing. All of these weeds, all, I'll say this about myself, ignorant and meaningless. Way too often, we withhold the best of ourselves, waiting for some image to show up exactly like we thought it would, without the trust that our life is providing us everything we need to bring forth the best of who we are. There's no such thing as a so-called perfect garden. There is the life that is in front of us and the call to love. And the biggest mistake any of us will ever make is refusing the life and the people and the opportunities that are presented to us to live fully and wholly and completely. And I'm so grateful for Gavin. Speaking of weeding, Karen Mazin Miller, a great Zen writer, wrote a book a few years back called Paradise in Plain Sight, Lessons from a Japanese Garden, and she talks to us about weeding. She tells us, anchor yourself low to the ground so you can get a good look at what you're dealing with. Use a spade to loosen the hard pack and go deeper. The next part is tricky. Take hold of the stem and apply your attention, allowing the root to release. Haste and carelessness will only aggravate the situation. Sometimes you can get the root on the first tug. Other times, you'll just tear off the top. Even if you don't get it all the first time, that's okay. It may take 2 or 3, 10 or 20, 100,000 or 1,000,000 times to get the root completely. Just keep going along like that, encountering the next weed that appears in front of you for the rest of your life. Keep tending that garden. What is really happening in my life today? What seed of my intention is this tied to? And how can I nurture my own becoming to get what I want in this situation? There's great wisdom in thinking like a gardener, but there perhaps is even more wisdom in thinking like a garden. Think like a garden. First way to think like a garden is that the garden doesn't worry. The garden doesn't worry. The garden's only intention is to bring forth the blessings that are within it to create life. Who of you by worry, the master teacher said, can add an hour to his life? In the same way, worry does not help us. But when we think like a garden, only bringing forth the best that is within us, we bring forth the best in our lives. Another way to think like a garden is that the garden is always enough. The garden is always enough. The garden never concerns itself with what's going on in someone else's garden. Could it possibly be that all you have to do in your life is to tend to your own garden and let the rest take care of itself? All you have to do is tend to your own garden and the rest takes care of itself. Consider this. If I can tend to my own garden by meeting my own needs, others can taste the fruit of my labor. If I can tend to my own garden and meet my own needs, others can taste the fruit of my labors. If you're like me, sometimes we can get so caught up in wanting to help others at the depletion of our own being. But perhaps being of service to others is really a result and a byproduct of caring for our own being, of making an example of our own garden. Lastly, the garden never dies. The garden never dies. It cycles. Is death a real experience for the garden? Absolutely. But there's no such thing as a beginning, a middle, or an end. And as gardens, we will move through cycles and seasons of our lives. Some of us are in summer. Some of us are in winter. But recognize that the truth of who you are is always in the soil. Pruning, letting go, allowing the environment to change and transform. There is grief and mourning in this practice. And yet, the life, the light, the resilience, the spirit within you is the most eternal thing there is and the greatest heart of each one of us. Our lives are about growing our garden, but it's also about allowing our garden to grow us. You tend and grow your garden, and your garden grows you, and it's amazing what demonstrates itself. I had one of the greatest demonstrations in my life 5 years and 2 weeks ago when our daughter, Nancy June, was born. Here I am, happiest moment of my life. And I experienced that with my daughter. No matter how challenging or good a day is, every time I see her is the happiest moment of my life. It's just awe-inspiring. And I don't know if I've shared this before, but I'm not sure we would have had Nancy June if we hadn't moved to Colorado. There's something that happens in life, and this, it was just, you know, one aspect was we moved from a two-bedroom apartment to a three-bedroom rented home. There's something when we create that space in our lives, when we step up into bigger things, even into the mystery and the unknown, that we create this space, and it's there sometimes. We weren't even looking for them, but the greatest blessings of our life occur. As you grow your garden grows you, and magnificent things take place. What I mean to say that by that as well is as you're using your creative mind within the creative medium of the soul of life, we nurture our relationship with God. We have a true experience of co-creation, and we begin to experience the true blessings, not of life, but of not just of life, but of being alive itself. Our Amish brothers and sisters, they tell us that the way to get closest to God is to get into the soil. Get into the earth. And that's my charge for us today, both physically, literally, and metaphorically, in the garden of our own consciousness. Get into the soil. Get into your life. Recognize yourself as a creative, powerful being, and know that there is a divine possibility in all that you do to get closer with divine source and presence. Lastly today, Karen Miller shares 4 rules for participating in a mindful garden. She initially came up with these for kids visiting her Japanese garden, but I'm encouraging us to apply them when exploring the gardens of our own mind and our own consciousness. First, be kind. What a novel idea. Instead of raging through the garden of my mind in a panic with a pitchfork, shaming myself, criticizing myself, questioning myself, what if I practice kindness and compassion in the garden of my own mind? If I could just do that, if you could just approach your own mind and consciousness with kindness, you would be infusing it with the greatest growth material possible. Practice kindness in the garden of your mind. Second, don't throw rocks. Good rule. Speaks to us of the idea, not that there may be hundreds of people to blame in your life, but there's nothing constructive about blame when it comes to nurturing and bringing forth the best of what is in your own garden. Take all that energy you may put into blame and put it in to harvesting your best qualities, your desires and intentions, the best of yourself. Next, no running. We don't move through our gardens quickly, but mindfully, patiently. If you run too fast, you're going to slip in the mud. You're going to be lying in the turds. You're going to be picking plants that need more time to grow, mistaking them as weeds. No running. give yourself equanimity and composure while moving through your garden. And lastly, pay attention. We forget that sometimes, that the best way to be in your garden is to look, to listen, and then ask, what does this garden need most to grow? And as we give it what it needs, it begins to provide for us the blossoms, the fruits, and the best of our lives. So moving into a closing prayer today, I invite any of our prayer practitioners to stand with me. And again, just bringing our mile-high heart to the Dalby family today. We affirm in this time of letting go of grief and of loss an eternal and undying love, knowing that the best of who Brad is in those he loved and those who love him, and that as his spirit moves into greater beingness in realms perhaps unknown, I know that the best of his love continues to nurture and to communicate with those who care most about him. And I know these truths for us as well, that there is a divine love, a divine recollection of the truth of who we are that is ever available to us, and that as we remember and bring it forth through the garden of ourselves and the garden of our lives, it provides healing, forgiveness, connection, and joy. And just grounding this experience today back into our wonderful spiritual practice, I invited Reverend Zamira to close our prayer.
And in this moment, moving into the center of your heart, just connecting there and feeling that communion, allowing this recitation of Yagani to nurture and to nourish the seeds that you are planting there, to nourish them with love. Yagani, 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 Yagani. And so it is.
Your mind is in control, even when you do not know. And if you let it idle, ain't no telling where it'll go. Imagine what you want, and get out of the way. You know, energy follows thought. So be careful what you say.
Thank you, Tom. It's a Willie Nelson song, isn't it?
That's true. Yeah.
A newer one, you said?
Yeah, it's a pretty new one by him. And I want to thank a very special congregant who sent that song to me just a few weeks ago. So.
Excellent. Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing it with us this morning.
Send me any songs you want. I love suggestions.
I was going to joke about a couple, but we can bring forth some creative ones. So as we move into our time of offering today, thank you for everything that you do to financially support Mile High Church. We are so very grateful. And it's so wonderful to remember that when we give to what spiritually feeds us, that experience of spirit increases and multiplies in our lives. So whatever you choose to give today, whatever amount, may we give it in affirming and giving thanks for that spirit that has blessed us, and know that as we give, it multiplies and expands in greater and greater ways all of the time. So in deep gratitude for the abundance of Mile High Church and in our own lives, let us take our gifts and say our offering affirmation together. It goes like this: Divine love, as me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I circulate, and all that I have. And so it is.
When there is love, I can't wait to talk about it. When things get rough, I like to walk with you. And when it's night, I like to be the light that's missing and remind you every minute of the future isn't written, not yet. When the heart gets heavy, we can lighten it up. And when you've had enough, oh, you can empty your glass and we can fill it back up. You know, it's up to us to make it all up. So what you're making up, I can make it up. There you could be loved no matter what. You know, the only time is right now. It's right here where you are. We don't need a vacation. To be happy, to feel things, to communicate and be heard. We sing out to project and to protect and to harmonize with birds. Even if it's your birthday or your dying day, it's a celebration to rejoice, to use your voice and give way to any old choice. Whatever you're choosing right now, it's right here where you are. You don't need a vacation. To the highest it can go. And trust me, hear me, if it makes you want to sing, then sing it. Ha-de-la-de-la-la-la. Ha-de-la-de-la-la-la. Let's all sing. Ha-de-la-de-la-la-la. We're connected now. Doesn't make me wrong, cause we all need the darkness to see the light in our own lives. Come on, sing it. Ha-de-la-de-la-la-la. Ha-de-la-de-la-la-la. Let's all sing. Ha-de-la-de-la-la-la. Lay it down. Everything is sound. Ha-de-la-de-la-la-la.
Thank you, Tom. As I said at the first service, that wah-wah, yeah, that takes talent. And you have it. All of you do. Thank you very much. And thank you, Reverend Josh, for a beautiful, beautiful message. Yeah, our gardens have been beautiful all summer. And I want to, speaking about a beautiful garden here, thank you for entering into Mile High Church today, if you're here for the first time. And we welcome you. And I'll be at the Welcome Center right after church. And also, more information either end of the lobby on the shelves about Mile High. And also, our blessed practitioners are down front. So if prayer is calling to you, please make yourself available in front of one of them.
Thank you, Patty. We wanted everyone to know here in the sanctuary that we're having to take a pause on our latte cart. Boo! Just for staffing reasons. But in the meantime, we've got Starbucks coffee in the community center, a big spread there. So go have some community, enjoy. There's a love donation bin, put a little in, and we'll have some even more stuff next week. And so please enjoy your spiritual community in the meantime. Hey, we've got great spiritual practices coming up Wednesday night, kirtan.
Wednesday night kirtan, this Wednesday night in the Vote Center from 7 to 9 p.m. I hope you'll come out and join us. You can meditate, you can chant, you can dance, whatever works for you, but I hope you'll join us, and we'll welcome the Bhakti Shakti band from Boulder, and they are quite fabulous, so I hope you'll be there.
Awesome, and we have Fall Fest coming up Saturday.
Yeah, different kind of spiritual practice. Come on out on Saturday from 10 to noon. It is a huge party with carnival games and candy. And if you've ever had little people in your life, this is the moment to bring them around. If you have friends who have little people, this is a perfect event to bring them to.
A little bit of chocolate is a spiritual practice. Works for me. Healing Light Service tonight at 5 p.m. in the Vote. This is a wonderful meditation and devotional experience. The Labyrinth is available as well outside and in the community center. So thanks so much for being here. If you'd like, stand, and we're going to say a benediction together. You can say it at home, too. Repeat after me. Something wonderful is happening to me right now. It is this thing called life. Life is in my mind, body, and all that I do. I give thanks for it, and I accept it. Just the way that it is, and just the way that it is not. Thank you, life.
Peace on earth, and let it begin.
Connected now, la 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 la
Whoa, 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 whoa.